Okay, so good morning. For today, so we will be talking about Rollo May, you know, and his existential psychology. Personally, this is one of my favorite theory, except kay Carl Jung. Although existential psychology kasi, hindi lang naman si Rollo May talaga ang nandyan sa existential psychology. Nandyan din si Viktor Frankl na nagsulat ng A Man's Search for Meaning, which is a story niya about being a survivor of the Holocaust. That is a good read if you want to read it. No, maikli lang siya. Siguro one day you can finish the book. Meron ako nun eh. Hindi ko alam. Hiniram yata. Hindi ko alam kung sino naghiram. But meron siya. Sobrang ganda. And existential psychology is more than a theory of personality din kasi. It's a philosophy. If you will look at it in a more broader perspective. Because yung existential part, it is actually a movement in philosophy. No? So, sa philosophy kasi maraming movement dyan, like reductionism, materialism, rationalism, empiricism, no? And then yan, papasok din si existentialism. Marami ding mga philosopher na nag-spearhead ng mga kanya-kanya nilang mga movement. No? And in existential psychology, yung nag-spearhead ng existentialism na philosophy, siya yung nag-influence kay Rollo May, which is si Soren Kierkegaard and others. Okay? So this topic is quite heavy, intellectually and emotionally speaking, kasi we will be talking about death in this topic. No? Sorry, may nagko-construction sa ano. But anyway, so let's start. Let's start again, as always, with Rollo May sa kanyang family and sa kanyang background. No? So sa family niya, education is not that, di nila gusto yung education, especially his father. To the point na sinisi niya ang education, no? Too much school. Kaya parang nagkaroon kasi ng psychosis yung sister niya. So parang yung sister niya is, di sinabi kung diagnose, but parang meron siya mga schizophrenic episode. And sabi nung tatay niya, yan, kaka-school-school mo yan. Parang yung modern day na, yan, kaka-cellphone mo yan. Pero sa kanila, kaka-school mo yan. And then, his mother is also quite neurotic. Ang tawag niya, Kitty, basta, Kitty Bichetta or something like that. No? Parang parang sinasabi niya, makate yung nanay niya or something like that. Siya yung nagsabi na, hindi ako. So, that is the family of Rollo. And then, of course, his father is also quite traditional in the view of society. So hindi sila ano sa education. Kaya si Rollo May parang nabuisit sa family niya. And nung nagkaroon siya ng chance na umalis sa kanilang bahay, umalis siya talaga. Ginaya niya si, hindi naman niya ginaya, pero parehas sila parehas ng nangyari kay Erickson. Parang, di ba si Erickson naging siyang hipster para lumibot siya sa buong lugar nila. And then ganun din yung ginawa ni Rollo May. So meron siyang gap year. And then in these 3 years, doon siya mas maraming na laman about sa sarili niya. And then eventually after nung gap year niya na yun is nag-apply siya for a teaching job. And then sa kanyang pagtatrabaho, doon niya nakilala si Adler. Nag-a-attend siya ng kanyang mga seminar. Kasi si Adler nun parang may mga nightly seminar siya, no? Tapos maraming mga humanistic psychologist ang na-influence ni Adler, knowing that Adler is also aligned with humanism, di ba? As you mentioned on your thought paper, because 90% of you wrote something about Adler. Kaya parang wow, sikat pala si Adler sa mga undergrad. Anyway, so naging na-influence siya sa mga works ni Adler and sa kanyang seminars. And then he had a brush with death, no? Muntik na siyang mamatay when he was infected by tuberculosis or with tuberculosis. During this time, hindi pa manageable ang tuberculosis, so talagang muntikan na siya, no? Parang pag nagkaroon ka ng tuberculosis noon, parang bahala na yung immune system mo kung magsa-survive ka or hindi. And apparently, nagkaroon siya ng kanyang, naging siyang mas kumbaga yung existentialism part niya is mas naging apparent dun sa tuberculosis na yun. Kasi literally, mutik siyang namatay. So literally, he stared the face of death. Hindi naman literally kasi. Figuratively, he faced death. And therefore, it made some lasting impressions in his own being. No, his main influence, no, as a hindi naman siya psychology. Kasi nung pumunta, nung nakilala niya si Adler talaga, dun pa lang siya nagkaroon ng interest sa human beings. Not necessarily psychology. Kaya nga yung dun sa interest niya na yun na ginawa niya, pumunta siya sa isang seminary para kumuha ng degree sa philosophy. Para mas maintindihan niya pa kung bakit ganyan or bakit yung mga humans is like this or like that. And in his excursion sa library nila siguro sa philosophy, na-encounter niya si Soren Kierkegaard na siya nga yung parang nag-start ng existentialist movement. So siya yung naging main influence niya sa kanyang theory. And he does not like theories of personality. Si Rollo May, no? Not because he cannot pass it or what, but sabi niya it is dehumanizing for the person, no, to apply, to make a theory about them, or and then generalize lahat yon sa isang mga tao. Ayaw niya daw yung ganun kasi everyone is unique, everyone has their own unique perspective of the world, no? Kaya ayaw niya yung theories of personality. You can imagine na Rollo May hating Freud, just like how Adler hated Freud. No? Anyway, so yan. So let's start, of course, with existentialism because dito nang galing ang existential psychology. Again, existentialism is a philosophical movement led by Soren Kierkegaard, Friedrich Nietzsche, my favorite existentialist, Friedrich Nietzsche, Martin Heidegger, and it's popularized by Jean-Paul Sartre. No? Sartre pala. And then Albert Camus, yung mga yan. Si Jean-Paul Sartre at Albert Camus, ano sila, mga writers sila, literary writers sila. Heidegger, Nietzsche, and Kierkegaard, they are writer of philosophy. So si Soren Kierkegaard, he is a Christian, actually. But existentialism yung ano niya. In-apply niya existentialism actually sa Christianity. Friedrich Nietzsche, on the other hand, mas hardcore siya. No? Siya yung founder, hindi naman founder, pero siya yung nag-start ng nihilistic existentialism movement. So yung nihilistic existentialism movement, meron siyang konting meaninglessness. No? Yun yung ano nila. Yun yung naging central point nila. But that is another topic na. And then Heidegger naman, siya yung nagpopularize ng phenomenology. No? Siguro kilala niyo sa Heidegger sa practical research too ninyo. Qualitative research. So phenomenology. Si Martin Heidegger yung ano dyan. Yung parang philosophical, theoretical ano nila. Theoretical anchor nila dun. So, yan, like Kierkegaard, like later existentialists emphasize a balance between freedom and responsibility. So, existentialism, there are, yung main topics niya is about freedom, responsibility, and then death, of course, existence and death. Because once we already know that we exist, we already know that we are going to not exist someday. So people acquire freedom of action through expanding their self-awareness and then assuming responsibility for their actions. And then the acquisition of freedom and responsibility, however, is achieved only at the expense of anxiety. As people realize that, ultimately they are in charge of their own destiny. They experience the burden of freedom and the pain of responsibility. So if this seems familiar, we have already talked about this with Eric Fromm. Connected lahat ng mga theory, whether we like it or not. So, yeah. May burden of freedom and may pain of responsibility. And this is where I came from. Kasi if you notice, I always say life is suffering. No? I always say na mamamatay din tayo lahat. And that is the influence of existentialism. Because back when I was in college, maliban sa pagbabasa ng theories of personality, is mahilig din ako magbasa about philosophy. Parang yun yung lagi kong pinupuntahan sa library. Tapos kilala na ako ng librarian na pag maghihiram ako, lagi mga philosophy books yung hinihiram ko. And I read Soren Kierkegaard and Friedrich Nietzsche. Super interesting niya talaga because dami kong hinihiram na book about sa kanya. And then yun. Baka kasi ang sinasabi nila is, we are responsible with our own lives. we have parang kumbaga ang main point nila is first, you're going to die. Second, we are free to do so everything we want. And third, we are kumbaga we are anxious about everything because one day we're going to die. So to be more clear, pag-usapan natin yung mga ano ng existentialism. So first tenet or first assumption ng mga existentialist, ng mga philosopher and existentialist is that existence precedes essence. Ang daming S. Kaya kailangan ko mag-de-esser dun sa... Anyways, existence precedes essence. It basically means that our existence or our existence must will define our essence. But what is existence? By existence means to become, no? Pag if you are existing, you're becoming, you're doing something, di ba? One pag sinabing a person exists, ano siya, parang nag-move siya, merong movement, no? Merong movement na nag-exist siya, I'm doing something, existence. So, meanwhile, essence implies a static immutable substance. Yung essence, ito yung parang esensya, ito yung parang main ingredient, no, ng isang tao. Okay? So, it's very abstract, so but please bear with me. We will illustrate it with an example. So, previous theories like psychoanalysis assumes that people are born with set of drives and needs, then which then influences how this person will become. So, remember Freud, according sa kanya, we all have our id, ego, superego, we have our needs, and we have our drives. And these needs and drives will then influence how we act, how we become, how we exist, how we become as a person. Okay? So, those needs and drives, those are essence. Yun yung essence ng pagiging tao, according kay Freud. And then, yung essence na yun, binibigyan niya tayo ng existence na following that essence. So, dahil ang essence natin is about sex and aggression, therefore, ang existence din natin is all about sex and aggression. Ganun ang psychoanalysis. And if you will read more about other theories, you will realize na halos lahat ng mga theories na pinag-uusapan natin is essence precedes existence. Ganun halos lang mga format nila. But existentialism people, on the other hand, assumes the other way around. No, our behaviors, our actions, our decisions, our existence will determine our essence. Parang sinasabi niya, the things we do, the things we think, the things we choose to do is the thing that will define us. Parang dun sa sinabi ni Batman, sa Batman Begins ni Christopher Nolan, kung kilala niyo yun. Parang dun sa ending nung, parang yung kasing basic, ano dun, basic, isang main takeaway ko dun sa movie na yun, is sabi niya, parang tinanong siya ni, nung babae, no, Rachel Dawes, nung nakamask na siya, naka-Batman na siya, parang naginala na siya na si Batman at si Bruce Wayne. Uy, spoiler pala, si Bruce Wayne tsaka si Batman iisa lang. Joke lang. So, parang sabi niya, who are you, sabi ng babae. Parang tapos sabi ni Batman, it's not the mask that defines me. It's not the mask that defines me. But what you do, what I do, that defines me, sabi niya. So, basically ang sinasabi niya, hindi siya Batman kaya yun. Sinasabi niya, ginawa niya tong mga to kaya siya naging Batman. Parang ganun. So that is existentialism. Everything that we do, everything the choices we make every day, that defines us, no? Yung mga actions natin ang nagde-define sa atin. And these actions are actually something that we can choose, no? Hindi kasi nga existence yun eh. We can choose to become like this, we can choose to become like that. And then our essence will become that. Okay? So I hope you get what I mean. Okay? So, nagets ba kung ano yung ibig sabihin ng existence precedes essence? So, that's good. Because ito yung maraming implications yung existence precedes essence, no? Napag-uusapan natin throughout the lesson. Next assumption naman is existentialism do not believe in the split between subjective and objective world. So, people, kasi before, just a context lang, Yun nga, sabi ko kanina, maraming movement ang nagawa sa philosophy. And during this time, before existentialism existed, merong dalawang force na naglalaban. Dalawang movement, dalawang philosophical movement na naglalaban with regards to the nature of our reality. The first movement is yung tinatawag nating rationalism, and then the second movement is yung empiricism. Parang nag-aaway sila. Sabi kasi ng mga rationalist, like René Descartes, subjective lang daw ang world. Ibig sabihin, everything exists only in our minds. Kumbaga, yung mga truths na na-formulate ng mind natin, ng rational thinking natin, those are the, yun daw yung truth. Siyempre, yung mga extremist na yun, mga yun. And then on the other hand, yung mga empiricist naman, mga empiricist like yung mga, di ko masyadong memorize yung mga empiricist. But basically, yung sinasabi ng mga empiricist, the objective world exists. And our subjective interpretation of the objective world will not change anything about the objective world. So for example, may isang ball sa harap mo, that ball will exist, even your mind will not exist. Kumbaga, yung ball na yan, kahit anong mangyari sa'yo as a person, meron pa rin ball sa harap mo. Sabi naman ng mga rationalist, yung ball na yan is just a construction of your mind. No? So, yun yung dalawang opposing sides. And then, pumasok si Kant. Although, wag na natin pag-usapan si Kant kasi hindi ko siya masyado naintindihan. And then, yung existentialism naman, sabi niya, anong pinag-aawayan nyo? Hindi nyo naman kailangan mag-away kasi parehas kayong tama. Walang, kumbaga, ang tao is both subjective and objective. Ibig niya sabihin, it is true that there's objective reality. It is true na merong ball dyan. But it's also true that each person has a different interpretation about that ball. Siguro ako, ang interpretation ko sa ball na yun is that ball is good. Ang iba naman, that ball is bad. But tapos yung iba naman, bakit may ball dyan? So meron tayong subjective interpretation sa mga objective na nangyayari sa buhay natin. So we are living in an objective world, and also we are living in a subjective world. So that is how people exist. Okay? Yun yung existence natin. We are both subjective and objective. Okay? So medyo philosophical na naman, di ba? That's why I decided to split this lesson into two parts kasi baka pag minadali ko, baka hindi nyo ma-digest ng maayos tapos mahirapan kayong intindihin kung ano ba yung existentialism. And also, I'm also biased. No? Kasi gusto ko talaga. Anyway, so existentialism also assumes that people want to find meaning in their life. People want to find meaning in their existence. Diba? We exist. And now, we want to know why. Why do we exist? That's also a part of our rational thinking, our subjective minds. I'm here, but why? So, we all have that feeling. Gusto natin malaman kung ano yung meaning ng life natin. And what is interesting about Friedrich Nietzsche is that, or yung mga nihilistic existentialist, is that, sabi nila, life is meaningless. walang meaning ang buhay. But, it is only, kumbaga, hindi niya naman sinasabing all hope is lost, na walang kwenta ang buhay. No? I always say this, wala namang meaning ang buhay. Kumbaga, wala siyang inherent meaning. Ang meaning ng buhay is dapat ikaw ang gagawa. So yun yung sinasabi ng mga nihilistic existentialist. Life is meaningless, therefore it is on your own hands para malaman mo kung ano yung meaning ng buhay natin. And each and every one of us, since we are just subjective people in an objective world, we can choose what meaning will be put on our lives. So kung kayo, parang nagtatanong kayo, ano bang meaning ng buhay? Ano bang ano? Walang meaning ng buhay. Kayong gumawa ng meaning ninyo. And that is part of our responsibility. Kumbaga, may freedom tayo to choose our own meaning. And in choosing that own meaning of our life, that is our responsibility then. That is actually good, no? It's quite liberating, at least for me, because I don't have to look for a meaning. I just have to construct a meaning for my life. Mas madali yun. Anyway, so that's another din ng existentialism. And then next is existentialist holds that ultimately each of us is responsible for who we are and what we become. Just as I have mentioned, our existence precedes our essence. Our choices, the choices that we make, the activities that we do, the behaviors that we behave, is all on us. It is, we cannot blame the parents, we cannot blame teachers, we cannot blame employers, we cannot blame God, we cannot blame the devil in our circumstances, in our personality. No? Because it is our responsibility. No? Because we exist in a world that it is our responsibility kung ano yung gagawin natin sa buhay natin. No? But, well, this is quite scary for some. Because if you cannot blame your teacher, if you cannot blame your parents, if you cannot blame God, then who will you blame? Of course, yourself. Because you are responsible for your life. So yun yung sinasabi ng existentialism. Okay, so minimim natin yung ano yung kasalanan ng mga parents lahat, no? But existentialist people, they say, yes, parents, teachers, employers, religion, society has a great impact, has a great influence in our personality. But, sabi ng existentialist, it's always on the person who will make the final decision. Kung magpapa-apekto ba siya dun sa mga nangyayari sa labas or papakinggan niya yung sarili niya. Such is the first principle of existentialism, sabi nga ni Sartre. So, di ba? Ang bigat, no? Existentialists are basically anti-theoretical. To them, theories further dehumanize people and render them as objects. This is, I've already told you about this. Yun nga, sabi ko, parang naging, yung mga theories kasi parang ginawa nilang mga guinea pigs, yung mga tao. Parang sinasabi nila, i-observe nila yung mga tao in an external way, in an objective manner, no? AKA scientific manner. Na maraming nag-comment about sa thought papers ninyo. No? Although that is fair because psychology wants to become a science and as a science, you must become objective. No? Sabi ng mga existentialist, that is not a way to go because if you do that, then you are removing the humanity of the person. And if you remove the humanity of the person, ano pang pag-aaralan mo? Wala na siyang humanity. Ginawa mo na lang siyang guinea pig, ginawa mo na lang siyang experiment. Yun yung mga issue ng mga existentialist sa mga hardcore scientists. So you can imagine existentialism and behaviorism. Kumbaga mga existentialist kasi sa tsaka mga psychodynamic perspective, they can still talk to each other eh. No? Pero yung existentialism tsaka behaviorism ni kilala niyo si Skinner tsaka si Pavlov. No? Pag mag-uusap siguro sila ni Rollo May, baka magsuntukan sila. Anyway, so because they are reducing people into mere objects. And that is, in reducing people into mere objects, removing their humanity, removing their subjective world, is a mortal sin, or if it's not a no-go para sa mga existentialist. Kasi nga, ang existence natin is something that is quite complicated than the cogs in the machine. Because we are people. And as people, we have our own subjective perceptions about life. So the theories may not apply on our lives most of the time, no? So yeah. So far, do you have any questions sa mga basic tenets ng existentialism? So, mga basic lang yan, ha? Actually, mas complicated pa yan, eh, pero we noted down na lang ng libro niya. Okay? May nagtataas ba ng hands?
Sir?
Yes.
Yes.
Di ba parang lumalabas na bias sila sa pagiging subjectiveness kasi hindi nila binibigyan ng chance yung objective kasi for example yung mga theories tsaka yung sa science, yung experiment, parang reality yun eh. Bakit hindi nila bigyan ng chance yung dun? Yun lang po, hindi ako galit.
I like that passion, by the way. But you're correct that they are not emphasizing. But I will disagree that they do not have a pakialam, no? Di naman sa wala silang pake. As I've mentioned kanina, existentialists say that the objective world still exists. Yun nga lang, yung objective world na yan is not really, kumbaga, it always pass through a subjective person. Even scientists, even mga hardcore science, they still have, because scientists are still persons, they still have the subjective perception. They still have their bias. They still have their own preconceived notions, no? Although scientific method will remove or somehow reduce that subjective bias, we cannot deny that subjectivity is still there. And being humans, studying humans, that is part of humanity, our subjectiveness. So parang ang sinasabi ng mga existentialist, bakit mo itatanggalin yung subjectivity ng mga tao? Di naman nila sinasabing mag-focus lang sa subjectivity. Ang sinasabi nila is i-include natin yung subjective perception nila. And of course, yung objective reality din natin. Kailangan din, kumbaga, yung part kasi ng objective reality nila is we are living in a world. And in this world, there are some things that we cannot change no matter how subjective we are. Kumbaga, objective-wise, people are going to die. That is objective. That is the truth. That is reality. People are like this. People are like that. That is objective. Our world is like this. Our world is like that. That is also objective. So what will we do about it? Yun, dun papasok yung subjective. So for example, may nangyari sa objective world mo na binagyo ka and then nasira lahat ng properties mo. That is objective. We cannot deny that. We cannot, hindi, mental construction lang yung bagyo. Hindi naman ganun, di ba? So that is objective. And existentialist people, they accept that because they know that life is suffering. The objective world is suffering, di ba? And then, ang sinasabi nila is, despite that objective reality, the person, it's himself or herself, still has the subjectivity to interpret the objective world. Yung interpretation na yun, kailangan nating isalang-alang in explaining humanity. Kasi lahat tayo, iba-iba yung mga pwede natin maging interpretation natin doon. And putting one theory on how we interpret the objective reality for them is not giving justice to how complex and how unique each person is with regards to interpreting the objective world. So ganun yung point nila when they say that they are dehumanizing people sa mga theories. Kasi marami talagang mga pwedeng explanations dahil yung subjective world natin is very unique, very complex. And not only that, it is quite different from people to people. Ganun yung sinasabi ng existentialist. Okay? So, are you satisfied with my explanation?
Yes po, thank you po.
Sige. But of course, you can still have your own opinion. You can still make your own assumptions there. Okay? But thank you for that question. No? May sinabi dito sa chat, sir, ganito po pagkakaintindi ko, existential depression, life is meaningless. Existentialism, nihilism, life is meaningless. Yes, you can say that. No? But of course, depende pa rin sa subjective perception, again, ng tao. No? These assumptions actually are assumptions muna sila, hindi pa sila yung dynamics mismo ng existentialism. Yung dynamics mismo ng existentialism is didi-discuss pa lang natin ngayon, no? So now, let's go to the basic concepts of existentialism. So as a person who exists in a both subjective world and an objective world, we as a people, as human beings, are in the world, no? Nasa mundo tayo. We are beings in the world. We are people with subjective perceptions and interpretation of the objective world. Again, existence natin is both subjective and objective. And in existentialism, ang tawag nila dyan is Dasein. So it's a phenomenological approach to understanding humanity. No? So yung illustration ko nga dito, hard sciences sees the world in an external way, much like how we humans look at the caterpillar we caught in a jar. Ganun yung mga hard sciences, no? Parang kukunin nila yung caterpillar, lalagay nila sa jar, observe nila kung anong ginagawa ng caterpillar. The caterpillar is doing this, the caterpillar is eating, the caterpillar is moving. Yun yung hard sciences, no? In that example, we are not in the world, no? Nasa labas tayo ng world. Kasi yung representation ng jar, yun yung world. Now, an existentialist now will tell you that the caterpillar may be scared, the caterpillar may be anxious, the caterpillar may be oblivious, hindi niya alam na nakakulong siya. So that is existentialism. Kumbaga, hindi tayo observer lang. We are also living in the world that we have now. Okay? So that's how Dasein works. That's how phenomenological perspective works. So now, before kasi, just like the caterpillar, we are united with the world. Because kasi ang mga hayop, basically, they are very subjective in nature. No? Nakikita lang nila kung ano yung nakikita nila. Wala silang pakialam sa reality ng mundo. But being the people that we are, we develop self-awareness, we develop consciousness, pwede na nating pwede tayong maging observer as opposed to pagiging participant lang. No? Siyempre, maraming advantage yun kasi mas naging ano nga tayo, mas naging advanced tayo, no? Kasi nakikita natin on an outside perspective yung mga ginagawa natin. But at the same time, dahil minsan sobrang objective natin, lagi tayong lumalabas sa world natin to observe the world, ang nangyayari is nagkakaroon tayo ng alienation. Na-alienate tayo sa world na meron tayo. The same way na wala tayong idea kung ano yung perception ng caterpillar sa jar niya. So, people sometimes feel that. People sometimes feel that they are not beings in the world, no? And for so many reasons, like they do not know who they really are, they do not know the world they're living in. And because of modernity, that's always the case right now. We have this alienated feeling of not being in the world. Okay? So as we gain more power over nature, we become more disconnected to it, like from the idea of existential dichotomy, no? We miss our union with the nature, with other people and with ourselves. So this feeling of isolation and alienation of the self from the self, of the self from the world is suffered not only by pathologically disturbed individuals, but also by most individuals in modern societies. I'm sure every one of us feel at one point in our life na we feel like we're not existing in this world. Parang we feel like iba tayo, no? Parang actually, if you will look at it in a more critical perspective, hindi na tayo beings ng nature, eh. No? We are our own beings na. We even created our virtual worlds, no? AKA the internet, where everything is awesome. And everything is awesome when you're part of a team. No? Joke lang. So, yun, alienated na tayo because of modernity. And usually it manifests in three areas. We are separated from nature, literally, because our dwellings are not connected to the nature, di ba? And then lack of meaningful interpersonal relations. May mga times na ayaw na lang natin makihalubilo sa ibang tao. And then lastly, we are being alienated from our true self or our authentic self. Why? Basically, social media. That's what I can say about it. No? So meron tayong three areas of life in Dasein. And these three areas of life is also known as the modes of being. So yung Dasein is may tatlong modes. So first mode is yung Umwelt, second is yung Mitwelt, and third is yung Eigenwelt. So Umwelt, it is the world of objects and things. So included dito yung nature, the world itself, no, and our katawang lupa. No? Kumbaga, part dito yung pagiging animal natin. It is the world of nature and natural law and includes biological drives such as hunger and sleep, such as natural phenomena as birth and death. So in short, yung katawang lupa natin. And Freud's theory, actually, its emphasis on biological and instincts, no, deals mostly with Umwelt. So si Freud daw, Umwelt lang yung mode of being niya. I mean, yung theoretically speaking, yun lang yung pinocus niya. And then, part din ng mundo natin, part din ng being in the world natin, is yung mga people na nakapaligid sa atin. And that is Mitwelt, no? Mitwelt or Mitwelt, di ko alam. German yan, di ako German. So we must relate to other people, not as things. If we treat people as objects, then we are solely living in Umwelt. So the theories of Sullivan and Rogers, with their emphasis on interpersonal relations, deal mostly with Mitwelt, no? And also Klein, and also Horney, and on some regards. Not purely, no? We can say that sina Horney and Klein, parang Umwelt tsaka Mitwelt sila. But the point is, this mode of being is being with other people. And then lastly is yung Eigenwelt, refers to one's relation to oneself. No? To live in Eigenwelt means to be aware of oneself as a human being and to grasp who we are as we relate to the world of things and to the world of people. What does it, kumbaga, ito na yung subjective part ng katauhan natin. No? May mga nangyayari sa objective world natin, may nangyayari sa Umwelt natin, sa Mitwelt natin, and then yung Eigenwelt natin is yung part ng Dasein or part ng being natin na nag-i-interpret sa mga nangyayari dun sa Umwelt tsaka sa Mitwelt natin. No? Ideally, healthy people will live in Umwelt, Mitwelt, and Eigenwelt simultaneously. So they adapt to the natural world, relate to others as humans, and have keen awareness of what all these experiences mean to them. So ideally, yung Dasein natin, dapat nagli-live tayo dun sa tatlong yon. Pag hindi tayo nag-live dun sa tatlong yon, eh, ma-alienate tayo. No? But sabi nga ng nandito, we always feel the isolation and alienation sa Dasein natin. So it is unavoidable to not live simultaneously in Umwelt, Mitwelt, and Eigenwelt. Paano ba yung manifestation yan? Kung masyado tayong nagli-live sa Umwelt, yung nakakalimutan natin yung Mitwelt tsaka Eigenwelt, masyadong nagiging externally ano lang tayo. Parang masyadong biological, masyadong natural. Kumbaga hindi na tayo kumoconnect sa sarili natin tsaka sa ibang tao. Ngayon naman, kung masyado naman Mitwelt, no, katulad ng culture dito sa Philippines, no, pinaka-importante yung pamilya, 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 although there's nothing wrong about that, pero kung syempre, kung sobra naman, di ba, yung talagang ini-invade na yung privacy mo, talagang pinihinihila ka na pababa kasi madaming pabigat or something like that, hindi na rin maganda kasi dinedeny mo yung Eigenwelt mo, dinedeny mo yung sarili mo. And at the same time, kung Eigenwelt na lang, ito naman yung nagiging sakit sa Western society na puro sarili na lang yung naiisip, so wala na silang connection with other people. No? So, yun yung hindi magandang mangyari. And usually, lahat ng tao is at some point in their lives, nangyayari yun. No? But ideally, dapat mabuhay tayo ng nasa Mitwelt, Umwelt, tsaka Eigenwelt. Because this is our existence. This is our life here on Earth. Okay? And of course, knowing that we are existing, knowing that we are beings in the world, of course, may kaakibat din yan na kasamang isa pang realization that there's a possibility of non-being. Okay? So, being in the world necessitates an awareness of a self as a living, emerging being. This awareness in turn leads to a dread of not being. That is, nothingness or nothing, non-being. Death is not the only avenue for non-being, although this is the most obvious one. One day we will die. And that's a fact. That's objective. Life, but according sa mga existentialists, life becomes more vital, more meaningful when we confront the possibility of our death. So the fear of death of non-being often provokes us to live defensively and to receive less from life. And then if we would confront the issue of our non-existence. So as May said, we are afraid of non-being, so we shrivel up our being. Who is not afraid of death? I think everyone is afraid of death. Even people who say that they are not afraid of death, siguro yung katawang lupa nila, matatakot dyan, no? Even suicidal people, they are afraid of dying. You might disagree with me, but in my experience kasi, it's not that they want to die, it's just what they want it to stop. Ayaw na lang nila. But anyway, that's another topic. Yung fear of death natin is something that everyone feels. It is an objective fact na lahat tayo mamamatay and lahat tayo natatakot mamatay. But it becomes less powerful if we confront that fear. Parang tatanggapin natin yung fear na yan. Kasi pag na-realize mo na mamamatay ka na, ang daming pwede mo maging ma-realize. No? For example, in this class, I will ask you will die one day. What do you feel about it? There are so many responses. But if we will deny or if we will tatakbuhan natin yung reality of death, ang tendency is mas lalakas yung power ng fear na din. Kasi dinideny mo eh. Diba? Following psychoanalysis or psychodynamic perspective, the more that you deny something, the more that it becomes powerful. Kasi for example, yung fear of death, ito yung reason kung bakit yung mga ibang tao is nililimitahan nila yung mga buhay nila. Kasi ayaw nilang ma-remind na mamamatay sila. No? Kaya anong ginagawa nila? Bumibili-bili ng kung ano-ano, bumibili ng mga food supplement, no? Pixie dust, kahit debunk na, kung wala naman talagang kwenta yun, anything, because they fear death. And they can, hindi nila na-confront yung idea of death. And to be fair, this is hard. No? Mahirap i-confront yung fear of death. But once you confronted it, sabi nga ni May, mas nagiging magugaan yung buhay. Kasi mas, kumbaga dahil na-confront mo na siya, parang less things in your mind na. No? But again, this non-being will produce a feeling of anxiety. No? People experience anxiety, and when they become aware of their when they become aware that their existence or some value identified with it might be destroyed. So again, we exist, and as we exist, we also know that we are not going to exist, and this non-existence or non-being will produce feeling of anxiety. So, ang anxiety ni Rollo May dito is hindi yung anxiety na nag-worry ka lang. So, this is ontological. This is part of our being. This is part of our life. Anxiety is a part of our life. We can never remove it. We can never remove the symptoms of anxiety. So, sinasabi ni Rollo May na we are apes with anxiety daw. Sabi, maraming memes na ganyan, you know? So anxiety then can spring from either an awareness of one's non-being or from threat to some value essentials to one's existence. And ano ba yung existence natin? Dasein. So pag sa dasein natin, may something na pwedeng mawala. For example, something sa world natin na pwedeng mawala, like properties natin, lupa, bahay, or something. O kaya sa mga relationships natin, no? Baka may mawala sa relationships natin or sa sarili natin mismo. Na akala mo, kilala mo na sarili mo, pero meron pa palang parts sa sarili mo na hindi mo kilala, it will produce anxiety. Kasi masisira yung existence mo eh. And we don't want that. And of course, alam din natin na mamamatay tayo, so that also produces anxiety. So the acquisition of freedom inevitably leads to anxiety. Freedom cannot exist without anxiety, nor anxiety can exist without freedom. So mamaya na tong freedom. But all you have to know is anxiety is experienced by everyone. If you are a human being, a human person, you will experience anxiety. And this anxiety, again, dahil nararanasan ng lahat, hindi naman ibig sabihin na may anxiety tayo is hindi na maganda yun. Kasi di ba yung for the past few lessons natin, lagi natin sinasabi, anxiety is the root of all problems, di ba? Pero sabi ni Rollo May, it's not necessarily that case, no? Because meron siyang tinatawag na normal anxiety. Normal anxiety to grow and to change one's values means to experience constructive or normal anxiety. So, dinefine niya to as proportionate to the threat, does not involve repression, and can be confronted constructively on the conscious level. So, yung isang example dito is, for example, nagkaroon ng changes sa dasein natin, especially yung Umwelt tsaka Mitwelt. This pandemic, yun yung nangyari eh. Napansin nyo? Noong 2020, na nagbago lahat, ang Umwelt natin or the world itself talagang nagbago kasi may virus, may ano, and so on and so forth. And not only that, yung Mitwelt natin nagbago kasi nagkaroon ng social distancing, nagkaroon ng ano. Kaya noong mga first 2 months ng lockdowns, it's very hard for everybody kasi the anxiety is real. No? And kasi may threat dun sa dasein natin, may threat sa dasein natin na magbabago yung dasein, especially the Mitwelt and the Eigenwelt. Ay, Mitwelt tsaka Umwelt. So, that anxiety is normal. Okay? So now, this anxiety then will lead us to adjust. Dahil nafe-feel natin yung anxiety na may magbabago, na masisira yung value natin sa Mitwelt tsaka Umwelt natin, ang gagawin natin is babaguhin natin yung interpretation natin sa nangyayari sa Umwelt tsaka Mitwelt using our Eigenwelt, no? So you, in my case, ang ginawa ko, so example ko naman yung sarili ko. So in my case, yung first 2 months talagang mahirap, but eventually nung naka-recover na ako, I thought about changing my way of looking at things, no? Kasi talagang very anxious, provoking yung ano nangyari dahil wala akong trabaho noon, wala akong naubos yung ipon ko. So, ang expect ko kasi by June or July, may trabaho na, pero June na, wala pa. So, anong ginawa ko? I tried to see what I have. Tapos, na-realize ko na ang marami ako is time. So, I use my time wisely. And then, parang nagkaroon kami ng mga yung clinic na kung saan ako nag-work, nagpa-part-time work ngayon is nagawa yun nung pandemic. tinulungan ko si yung aking boss sa paggawa ng clinic na yun. Kasi wala akong oras. And then, nagawa yung clinic. And then of also, ginamit ko yung time ko to create a website. Wala lang, para doon kumalagay yung mga, ano ko, yung mga essays ko. And then, nakagawa ko ng ano, website. And then din ako nagplano na gumawa ng YouTube channel. And then yun, doon ko rin daan yung YouTube channel ko. No? Na alam ko kasi na mas maraming time ngayon dahil work from home and all. So, that anxiety, no? That anxiety of the change in the Umwelt and Mitwelt forced me, or at least I chose to force myself to adjust. So, yun yung normal anxiety. Yun yung pwedeng magawa ng anxiety sa atin. Kasi kapag anxious ka, gusto mong tanggalin yung anxiety mo. So, paano matatanggal anxiety mo? By changing some things in your life. No? Changing for the better, of course. Now, nagiging masama lang ang anxiety. Nagkakaroon lang ng sa masamang epekto ang anxiety sa isang tao kapag dinedeny niya yung anxiety, pag nire-repress niya. No? So, a reaction which is disproportionate to the threat involves repression and other forms of intrapsychic conflict and is managed by various kinds of blocking off activity and awareness. So, whereas normal anxiety is felt whenever values are threatened, neurotic anxiety is experienced whenever values become transformed into dogma. So, yung kanina, di ba, nagkaroon ng threat sa value. So, anong ginawa ng tao? Anong ginagawa ng normal anxiety? Babaguhin niya yung values niya. Babaguhin ko yung values ko. Binago ko yung values ko in that case. No? Parang yung values ko na employee lang ako, gumawa ako ng way para magkaroon ako ng ibang source of income. So, that is changing your values. But, if a person did not change his values, instead, talaga nag-double down pa siya dun sa values niya na hindi na tama sa, kumbaga, disconnected na sa Umwelt, tsaka sa Mitwelt, tsaka sa Eigenwelt niya, dun na nagiging neurotic anxiety. Yan. So for example, in my case, kung hindi ko pinansin yung anxiety ko, another example, yung anxiety ko with regards my Eigenwelt na hindi ako bagay sa architecture. Ang tunay kong course talaga na gusto is psychology. Pag hindi ko tinanggap yung anxiety na dinala, or kasi magkakaroon ako ng anxiety na hindi naman talaga ako architecture, dapat psych yung major ko eh. May anxiety yun. Ngayon, kung hindi ko pinakinggan yung anxiety, yung normal anxiety na yan, nirepress ko, tapos sasabing, hindi, magkocommit ako dito sa architecture, tutuloy-tuloyin ko to. So, ginawa kong dogma yung value ko. So, kapag nangyari yun, dun na mag-uumpisa yung neurotic anxiety. Kasi deep down within you know that is wrong. You know that is not how you live in your Dasein. So in that way, masyado na akong na-alienate. Alienated na nga ako nung una, mas na-alienate pa ako kasi nag-double down ako dun sa maling value. No? So to be absolutely right in one's value provides temporary security, but it is security brought at the price of surrendering one's opportunity for fresh learning and new growth. So this is similar with neurotic claims. So of course, this anxiety is not only applicable dun sa mga scenario na yon, like yung pandemic and yung course shifting courses. This is also applicable with our non-being. Diba? As mentioned nga kanina, anxiety forms when value can be destroyed in your existence or awareness of non-being. So, yung awareness of non-being, mas general siya. So, yung awareness natin of death can be confronted and be treated as normal anxiety. And some people, or most people, do not confront it, therefore repress it, and it become neurotic anxiety. And kapag nirepress natin yung death or nirepress natin yung idea of death, that one day we're gonna die, it will produce so much defensiveness. Magiging hindi na natin ifulfill lahat ng mga gusto nating mangyari, yung mga gusto nating gawin. Kasi nga, ang hirap explain eh, pero pag kasi takot kang mamatay, parang ang ginagawa mo is dinidim mo yung consciousness mo. So sobrang pagdim mo sa consciousness mo, parang hindi mo na maiisip na mamamatay ka one day. So pag dinidim mo yung consciousness mo, yung mga nangyayari sa objective world na supposedly pwedeng makatulong sa'yo is nire-reject mo na din. Nadadamay sila sa pagde-deny mo ng death. No? So, for example, you know that, kumbaga, dahil alam mo na may chance na mamatay ka sa pagpunta dito sa lugar na ito, eh, hindi ka pupunta. So that is limiting your experience. So kaya naman, sa merong isang opportunity na mapunta ka dito sa isang opportunity na to, pero dahil takot kang mamatay or takot kang masira yung Mitwelt, Umwelt, Eigenwelt mo, dahil magbabago ka eh, may pagbabago eh, i-repress mo yon. So hindi mo ipupush yung opportunity. No? For example, you want to create a business or you want to create a YouTube channel, no, but you are secret, kumbaga, you are repressing that fear of failure and fear of being non-being kasi nga madi-disconnect ka sa Eigenwelt mo or sa Mitwelt mo or sa Umwelt mo. So hindi mo na ipa-pursue yung opportunity na yon. Diba? So nalilimit yung experience natin as a person. So that is neurotic anxiety kapag dinideny mo yung mga bagay-bagay na reality ng mundo, especially the death itself, no? Kaya nga, pansinin ninyo yung mga matatanda, no? Pag pinag-uusapan yung death, ayaw nila. Minsan, iniisip ko, unconscious yun eh. Pag pinag-uusapan na yung death, parang iibahin nila yung usapan, no? Kaya yung mga iba, ayaw nilang pag-usapan yung mga retirement plan, din ayaw nilang pag-usapan yung mga, alam nyo yun, yung St. Peter, ano kasi, kasi yung tawag dun, yung mga death something, no? Ayaw nilang pinag-uusapan yun. Kasi may neurotic anxiety, no? Sa most people. And then may mga ibang tao naman na talagang very open sa death, no? But then again, that is neurotic anxiety. Okay? So now, because we are limiting ourselves, we are limiting our experiences, ang nangyayari is, dinedeny natin yung sarili natin sa mga potentialities natin as a person. And because we deny our potentialities, we feel guilty. No? We feel, nagigilty tayo na hindi natin nagagawa yung mga pwede natin gawin talaga as a person. Nagigilty din tayo na hindi natin nakikita yung mga pangangailangan ng mga tao sa paligid natin, also known as Mitwelt, dahil nilimit mo yung Mitwelt mo. O kaya naman, nagiging oblivious tayo sa dependence natin sa natural world. This is more general yung obliviousness sa dependence natin sa natural world. For example, nakakatawa, no, sa ibang bansa, kunyari sa US, kapag yung manok is naka-chop-chop na manok na, talagang gustong-gusto nilang kinakain, no? Pero pag, for example, pupunta sila sa mga third world country, tapos makikita nila kung paano katayin yung manok, kung paano patayin yung manok, nagkakaroon sila ng guilt. So that is guilt din, no? Nagkakaroon sila ng guilt na dahil disconnected na sa nature, eh. No? Tapos pag na-confront sila ulit din sa fact na ganun pala yung ginagawa sa mga manok bago nila kainin, parang mga mahinang nila lang. Joke lang. So nagkakaroon ng guilt. So again, same with anxiety, this guilt is also ontological. Ibig sabihin, lahat tayo eh part to ng package ng pagiging, ng pag-exist natin as a tao. No? And ang guilt, it can arise in certain modes of being like Umwelt guilt, Mitwelt guilt, and Eigenwelt guilt. Yung Eigenwelt guilt pa siyang Jonah complex, no? And yung mga nasabi ko kanina, those are example of how we experience guilt. And same with anxiety, ontological guilt can have either positive or negative effect. Depende kung i-accept mo or i-deny mo. Kasi kung i-accept natin tong guilt na to, i-accept natin yung guilty feeling na hindi tayo nakakonect ng masyado sa ibang tao, and hindi tayo nakakonect masyado sa world natin, eh, ma-force tayo na mag-make up for it. No? So for example, yung guilt nat Mitwelt guilt natin, no? We will improve our relationship with others. Kasi nga feel alam may guilt feeling sa atin na parang hindi na natin sa satisfy or hindi na natin naalagaan yung mga relationships natin. O kaya naman for example sa Eigenwelt natin, yung Eigenwelt guilt natin. So we will try to use our talents, our capabilities in pursuing our potentialities creatively. And then sa world din naman natin, magkakaroon tayo ng deeper respect sa nature. Parang re-respetuhin natin, mas re-respetuhin natin yung nature na lahat ng kinakain natin is nanggagaling somewhere, somewhere in the world na kumbaga kailangan natin alagaan yung mundo kasi pag nawala na yung mundo, mamamatay tayong lahat. So that is the good thing about guilt. Now again, if we will deny that guilt, we refuse to accept ontological guilt, it becomes neurotic. And itong guilt na to, kapag hindi natin pinansin, ang tendency, parang sasabihin na, wala namang mali sa mga relationships ko ah. Pero alam mo, deep down meron. So ano mangyayari? Hindi ka mag-force na to make more connections with other people, which will make you depressed or something like that. O kaya maging sexually impotent ka, kasi hindi mo alam kung ano yung gusto mo as a person. Kaya naman magiging cruel ka sa ibang tao or mas malala is you will have the inability to make choices. Mahirapan kang anong gagawin ko, ito ba yung gagawin ko, yon magkakaroon ng impotence. Parang hindi mo na dahil guilty ka, kumbaga dahil dinidenate mo yung guilt mo na well, there's nothing wrong naman. I'm good, I'm a good person. But deep down alam mo hindi ka a good person, parang hindi ka makakapag-decide kung anong gagawin mo. Okay, so that is the effect of neurotic guilt. Okay, so if we will take it, if we have to learn something here, is that dapat yung guilt, yung anxiety of existence, dapat natin tanggapin as it is, because it will help us improve ourselves. It will help us become more ingrained in our Dasein. So, as you can see, parang yung connection niya is we exist in the world, and as our existence, well, we are aware that someday we will be non-existent or that our existence can be destroyed, no? So, with that in mind, nagkakaroon tayo ng anxiety sa buhay natin. And dahil sa anxiety natin, minsan may mga times na lilimitahan natin yung experiences natin, and following that is also our potentialities. And when we limit our potentialities, nagkakaroon tayo ng guilt. Okay? But the most important thing here is that we must accept the anxiety and we must accept the guilt and do something about it. Okay? So, but we have a choice not to do that. So that's how human conditions work. This is our destiny. We are destined to become anxious. We are destined to become guilty. We are destined to die. That's how existentialism is. Okay? So, ayan. Yun na yung mga basic ng existentialism. Of course, there are so many things about existentialism pa, like meaning in life and all, but we will not be talking about too much about that. Maybe as we go along, pag-uusapan natin. The problem with Rollo May's theory is that masyadong disconnected yung mga ibang concepts niya. No? Kasi sinulat niya yung mga concepts niya on a span of many books and many essays. Kaya parang may mga times na parang compartmentalize yung mga bagay-bagay. Like this, basic concept of Rollo May, intentionality. Anong connect niya dun sa mga nauna? Although may connect naman siya, kasi yung connection niya is nasa subjective and objective world. So kasi for example, in this case, yung intentionality, it is our ability to make a choice or imply some underlying structure that the choice is made, no? Intentionality is to bridge the gap between subject and object. Di ba parang saan ang galing yun? Kanina, anxiety, guilt, yung pinag-usapan natin that may intentionality. Kaya medyo, ayan. Kaya nahirapan akong gawin yung script dun sa video natin. Kasi ganyan yung mga topics niya. But anyway, do you have any questions with regards to the basic concept ng ng anxiety and guilt? Meron ba? Gets naman ba? So, with that, we will end muna doon kasi medyo marami na tayong napag-usapan tsaka ang daldal ko. We will continue our discussion next meeting, although pre-recorded na yung ano. And then, ano ba? Yun, we will finish it on our next meeting na lang. Okay? So, I will end the recording.